Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. Hope you guys have enjoyed your Christmas holidays with your family and friends. And in the spirit of the new year 2020, I have for you guys a video today on some traveling hacks and tips I've collected throughout the years since I am traveling. It's been a few years of traveling. I remember when I was young, I never would imagine I'd be on a plane. But in the last 10 years, I've traveled quite a bit, and I just wanted to tell you guys the things I've learned over the years. I did a lot of mistakes in the beginning. Lack of planning, lack of not knowing, because I've never traveled before. And so I wanted to share with you guys, because in 2020 we are saying yes to new adventures. Before I start guys, I just want to remind you to remember to subscribe to my channel, like the videos and click the notification button so that when you have a new video you can be notified. And I hope you like the new look of the channel. You're trying to be consistent and you're enjoying the content. If you want me to change anything, if you'd like me to add a few things or more content, let me know what you want me to shoot in 2020. And I'm here ready to do it. So I'll start from the beginning, which is planning your trips. So what I do is, like, now a few days to 2020, or I'll just be very honest guys, I've planned my 2020 trips from June 2019, and by June, July of 2019 I had an idea of the trips that I'll be taking in 2020. God willing, you cross your fingers, because anything can happen, you know. So what I do is I always write down where I'd like to go. So in 2020, I'd like to travel to 12 countries. It's a very significant year in terms of my birthday. So I added two more countries, because I usually try to do 10, so I did 12. And so what I tend to do is I book the trips in advance. One, because it saves me money, because when I book the tickets in advance, I can end up even paying half price the fare. Number two, it helps me plan in terms of who am I going to leave the kids with, in terms of what activities are going to happen around, in terms if the kids have school meetings, events. So now I plan who's going to go for them when I'm away. If I'm traveling alone, then I'll be able to give Mike a brief on what to do. And then also, why do I plan ahead, is because I mostly travel when the kids are in school, which is more convenient for me, and when the kids are at home. Another thing, booking the tickets, the hotels also in advance. I book the pickup in advance. Then I'm able to know and gauge the amount of time it takes for me to get my visa. For example, countries like Belgium, some Scandinavian countries will take 6 months for you to get your visa, so you plan in advance. And you can even find ways, like my last Europe trip, if I wanted to go to Belgium, if I went to the Belgian embassy in Kenya to take the visa, it had taken me long. So what did I do? I went to the Italian embassy, because it's under the same EU community. So when I got my Italian visa, which now will enable me to go to these other countries, you get, I was able to go to Belgium, Germany, and I didn't have to go to each individual embassy to get the visa. So that's what I'm saying by planning early and in advance. It saves you money and saves you a headache. Number two is in terms of checking your passport and checking the number of pages you're remaining with in your passport. I was able to convert my passport to the South African passport, which helps. So it's important to check on the packages in terms of your health insurance and travel insurance. You can get an insurance, like mine, my insurance company has a very affordable travel insurance and health insurance. So the problem is, when you push it to the last minute, you'll not be able to negotiate a good rate. So what I do, I negotiate in the beginning of the year when I'm negotiating my car insurance. So travel and health insurance is in that bracket, which saves you money. Another thing is, in terms of planning, you can buy, like I said, buy tickets early. I don't do it personally, because I have a travel agent, which makes life easier. But I'd suggest, if you can be able to book yourself, I think the best is, a Tuesdays or Thursday. If you're buying it online, because then the tickets are cheaper, you can find that out. There are sites where you can buy tickets. My kids buy their own tickets and they are able to save money. And also, if you buy early, you're able to get upgrades easily in terms of using your miles. Number two, in terms of planning, is packing before you travel. So there are a few things you need to pack before you travel. I always carry two suitcases, which are big, which I check in, and one carry-on. Why do I carry two suitcases? It's because I need space for things I've bought when I'm coming back, and I don't want to buy a new suitcase and have extra luggage, which I'll be charged more. So what I do, I just carry a few clothes, what is necessary, on the two suitcases, so they're like half empty, so that when I'm coming back, I at least have one full suitcase to put stuff that I've bought when I'm coming back. On the carry-on, I don't travel with electronics, because I hate the security check where I have to remove my laptop and my iPad and a camera. So rule of the game, on my carry-on, I don't do electronics. When I travel, I don't do a belt, I don't do jewelry, I don't do a watch, because what tends to happen is when I'm going through the security, is at the check-in, I'll end up putting them in like a small container and then I tend to forget. So what happens, you can lose your good quality belt, watch, jewelry, and that's the end of it. So I travel without that. In terms of the carry-on also, I usually pack extra clothes, like I'll pack a top, a pair of jeans, shoes I never do, like innerwear, and I'll pack some moisturizer because in the plane it gets very dry and my face gets dry. I carry perfume, a small little one, because you're only allowed not more than 100 ml, I think. I'll carry a toothbrush, a small toothpaste if you have to. I don't because you're usually given in the plane. I carry a toothbrush because the toothbrush they give you on the plane is very hard for your gum, so it can make you bleed. So I carry an extra toothbrush. I usually carry lip balm, wet wipes, sanitizer, tissues, because you tend to touch many places. So I usually like to clean my hands. What else do I put on my carry-on? A book, a notebook, a pen. Yes, if I'm going to a cold place, I always put an extra jacket because inside the airport, it's not very cold. But when I go outside, I need to layer up. So normally I'll put an extra jacket, gloves, a scarf, and a hat if I'm going to a cold place. I ensure to have small little bags. And also, if I have, like, let's say the small perfume and things that need to be seen on the transparent bag, because the security guys have a certain bag. You need to have a transparent bag so where they can see your toiletries. It's a carry-on bag that I've been traveling with. It's a Michael Kors one, just a basic bag, because I don't want to carry my very valuable bags because they tend to get messed up. So it's a crossbody bag. I'd have preferred it to have a zip, but this one doesn't have. It actually has a lock, which is quite hard to open. So ensure everywhere you go that this bag is locked. There's a time I remember, let me tell you a brief story before I continue. I was in China, I was 7 months pregnant. I lost my passport, guys. There's nothing as bad as losing your passport. What happened? I went to a mall to buy last minute things. I was traveling the next day. So this, let's say I'm traveling on Wednesday, so it's Tuesday afternoon. And then I was shopping, and what I did, I left my bag open. It was a cross-body bag. And then I was shopping and there were guys around me. Before I knew it, I was actually paying, so I removed my wallet, I left it open, and my passport was there. Because in China, you can't walk around without your passport. If the cops stop you, you have to show your passport. Guys, I lost my passport. I was 7 months pregnant in a foreign country. My translator had just left that day in the morning going to another country. So I'm in a foreign country, don't understand the language. I'm in a mall, my passport is lost. I felt like the world had just ended. I just turned black and dull. And so what happened, I ended up staying in China for 1 month, 30 days instead of 2 weeks, because by the time, because I was in Guangzhou and the Kenyan embassy is in Beijing. It's in Beijing. So by the time the embassy had to send a translator who was a Kenyan student from Beijing to Guangzhou, to come and be taking me to the immigration, because I used to go to immigration on my own, and they would be like, there's a language barrier. First of all, they think I am Nigerian, because we all look alike to them, and they think that I have lost my passport purposely so that I can get more extra days, because that's what they tend to do. And so I used to go every morning, I'm so frustrated. I leave in the evening and I haven't achieved anything. So until they got the translator to come. And I remember that day when it was like after 2 weeks, I went to the immigration, this guy was translating to them, and I just broke down. I was like, I have to go home. My gurario is 2 days away. I should have been at home planning for my gurario, and here I am. So I landed like this that night, and the next day was my gurario. So guys, losing a passport is not funny. So always ensure you have a crossbody bag and close it. If you can, better if it's a zip even. So that's a tip and an experience that I have learned. On that note, ensure that you take, scan your documents, passport, travel insurance, medical card, driving license, ID, scan it, save it on your phone. And better still, send it to someone close at home, like maybe your partner, your kids, your assistant in the office. So in case you lose your phone, in case you lose your passport, you're able to sell them, send me these original documents. Please ensure to do that. It's very, very important. If I hadn't scanned my passport and all that, I'd have had a very hard time when I lost my passport. So ensure to scan your documents and also your ticket details, because you have them on your phone, screenshot it. Because the thing is, you can go to a place and you don't have access to Wi-Fi and you can't open your WhatsApp or your email. So just take a screenshot so it's on your phone. So now we are still on the suitcases and the documents. Ensure to always put something on your bag to identify it. I usually buy these identifiers, but also you can put like maybe a cheetah print scarf or something so that you can identify your bags. Because most bags are usually black, red, navy blue, unless you have something special like to identify your bag. Luggage does get lost. I've never had my suitcase getting lost, but that's why I always carry an extra pair of clothes on my carry-on. Oh, guys, another thing is if you're having many, if it's a very, very long flight, like let's say from the States to Kenya and you'll stop in Dubai for a while, I prefer you wrap your suitcase because that protects your suitcase and also it's a good security feature to ensure that your things get here safely. Now we'll go to what you need to carry in terms of medicine, guys. It's important when you travel, you have to carry medicine. Number one, if you're someone who has diabetes, high blood pressure, whatever condition that you have to take your medicine, pack your medicine. Always have extra because you never know, anything might happen. Like if you're going for 14 days, carry for 30 days in case of any delay. Number two, painkillers. Number three, antibiotic, guys. I got sick in LA. I got tonsils, guys. I went to Mount Sinai, I think people who know it in LA, so I was rushed there. First of all, they put me in a room, it's like I had Ebola because I'd come from Africa. And then after that, they write for you a prescription, you have to go buy the medicine. Don't forget, only that cost me like $500. Like medical is so expensive outside the country. So I went to the pharmacy and they had written for me amoxicillin. Guys, even in Kenya, we don't take amoxicillin. So I always carry antibiotics. It is so hard to buy antibiotics outside the country, especially in the UK, the States, in Europe. It's not easy. It's not like here where you walk in and just buy your drugs. So painkillers, your normal everyday drugs, antibiotics. I usually carry charcoal tablets because of being bloated. You'll Google it. They're there. Bicarbonate of soda. I always carry bicarbonate of soda, where I mix it with water and I mix it with a bit of lemon wherever I am. It helps also with having indigestion because I do not like plain food. If there's one person who doesn't take plain food, it is me. So, another thing is carry your multivitamins. If you're a person who has bad jet lag, you can buy jet lag drugs. They're everywhere at the airport. And you can also buy, for people who get allergies, but take your allergy medicine, and I always carry Flugon. So that's in terms of packing your medicines. And even when my kids go away to campus, I always pack for them those things. Another thing I've learned, because like I said, I don't like plain food, I always go to the airport if it's an international flight 2.5 hours or 3 hours before I fly. Why? Because I want to check in comfortably. Sometimes you go to the airport and that is a night where the lines, I don't know, where there's so many planes taking off. So just to avoid the rush, I always go 2.5 hours or 3 in advance. So I check in nicely, I put in my bags, and I also have a heavy meal. So my meal will contain protein because I want to be full for long. So I always have a heavy meal and I always have enough water. Ensure you have enough water, just so that you don't get dehydrated. And so when I enter the plane, I usually have a no disturb sign. Before we even leave, I am asleep. I am asleep and gone. So normally I will wake up in between just to maybe have water. I normally don't take coffee in the plane. Why? Because I don't trust those. You know the things they have water in, they remove water from on the plane. Even if you Google, they are usually flushed out or cleaned. Like, you know, there you have a water dispenser after maybe 6-4 months. So me, I'm not about to have coffee on the plane or tea. So what do? I just have water, alcohol, yeah, and maybe soda. So I rarely will have coffee or tea because the only water I'm having is bottled water. And also another thing about arriving the airport early, in case you've forgotten something, you can send a border board or something to bring it for you. I hate my name being called. It has never happened, guys. I remember I missed my flight once. I was coming from the UK. It was Emirates. I got to the airport. What made me late is there was traffic because I didn't estimate my time. And then I got there, I wrapped my bags. I think at the desk like this, they just closed to check in the bags 2 minutes ago. The plane has not left the runway. It is there. Actually, we have another 1 hour to boarding and they refused to check me in, guys. All the tax return money I had gotten back, I had to use it to buy a new ticket. That was painful. So guys, always just estimate your time. Traffic, if you're coming 1 hour away, so estimate your time. If you need to leave your 4 hours before, please do, to ensure that you have a comfortable and enjoyable flight. Okay, so another advantage of checking in early, you're able to get your desired seat, because if you come late, you will be put in the middle of the aisle near the toilet. So now I'm inside the airport, I've eaten, I'm checking in, I'm going through security. Like I said, my carry-on doesn't have any jewelry, any electronics. I'm wearing comfortable clothes, meaning I always travel in my jeans a tee. I have to have a jacket because it gets cold. And I have always comfortable shoes, sneakers, because sneakers doesn't have any metal inside them. Another thing I've learned is I always carry two pairs of socks. So if I've worn socks, I'll carry another pair of socks. So in case a security guy tells me to remove my shoes, I'm not going to step down with the same socks that I'm going to wear. So I'll wear the second pair of socks, step on the floor, go to the other side, remove it, and put it in the carry-on bag. Because there's nothing as bad as being told to remove your shoes, and then you don't even have socks, and you're stepping on that ground and filthy ground. Okay, if you have OCD like me, and that is really bothering. So always carry extra pair of socks and shoes that don't have any metal. So what happens is I usually go through the security and there's nothing beeping. I usually feel sorry for guys. They go, remove your belt. Go, remove your shoes. Removing your laptop and stuff. So to make life easier, guys, comfortable, try and minimize your metals. For in terms of money, ensure that you have loaded your credit card. I prefer credit cards and debit card, but what I do, I load both of them from here. I notify my bank that I'm traveling so that they don't think someone is stealing from you. And I always carry the currency. Let's say if I am going to Dubai, I already have those dirhams before I leave here. So I change at the bank. Why? Because when I land, the exchange rate at the airport is usually crap. So you end up losing money. So I'll carry like a few dirhams. And also it's easier to withdraw dirhams from the ATM than to change on the Forex because it's much more expensive. In terms of countries where, let's say like European countries, where you have to put the coins in to get your trolley to push the luggage, ensure that you have some euros with you in terms of coins, 1 to 10 euros in terms of coins, so because you can need to slot them in to get your trolley to push your luggage. Otherwise, you're stuck with 4 or 5. Pieces of luggage. Before you land, ensure to confirm that there's a person picking you up on the other end. So what I usually do is before the plane takes off, I communicate to the person who's receiving me on the other end. We ensure that our timing is correct. So by the time I land, I know someone is picking me up. There's no bad thing as you reach the airport and you're stranded. And then sometimes the taxis outside there, you can't trust. Some countries, like let's say in India, if you don't, some countries are dangerous. Like I get there and I pick any taxi and anything can happen to me. People have been stolen money, they've been taken to wrong destinations. So I prefer to have a trusted person on the other side waiting for me to take me to the hotel. Also, ensure to have your hotel voucher and you have communicated your hotel on your arrival date, confirming time and arrival. If you're late in terms of your flight, notify them, send them an email. And like I said, booking early ensures you to get the best rates. Yeah, so when you get to the hotel, normally what I do before I go to my room, I ask them where is the nearest train station, because some countries, most of them, like in the European countries or outside Kenya, they are train stations. So I don't tend to use Ubers or taxis because they're quite expensive. The people receiving you at the hotel, they always give you clues on in terms of how to get around so that the next day when I wake up, I'm already ready to go and I know where I'm going. In terms of sites, I usually plan ahead, like which sites I'm going to go, where am I going to visit, am I going to have a meeting. So then I wake up the next morning, I'm more disoriented. I already know where I'm going. If I was supposed to call someone, I call them the night before and rearrange. When I wake up in the morning, I'm ready to go. In terms of shopping list, I usually have a shopping list that I've written down before I leave home, saved on the phone. And let's say if I promise to buy someone something, what I tend to do is I buy those things first before I buy my things, because then again, so that my money doesn't run out. And this also helps you have a budget. In countries where you get tax-free, which are many countries, the UK, European Union, you get your tax back. So what I do, they usually have Global Blue, or they usually have the other one called, I'm forgetting. So you see, I have this in my wallet. So what I do, I ensure to get my tax return. So you get a tax return at the airport. So if you buy high-value items, ensure to have them in your carry-on or in your check-in bag, because you go get your tax before you check in the bags. It's on the top, because sometimes they want to see the stuff. And most people tend to not get their tax free because they haven't planned well, meaning whatever card you bought with, you need to have it with you, your passport, your ticket, and an original receipt from the shop where you bought the stuff. So sometimes you even get tax free returns worth thousands of shillings. You can even get $2,000 depending on what you bought. And that means then I have more money to come back home and save for my next trip. So ensure to plan your shopping and get your tax free return. Check whichever country you're in. If you enter the shop, ask them, do you do tax-free returns? Because they have to give you a form so which you can produce at the airport when you're exiting. What else? In terms of when I'm packing and I'm coming back home, I always remove all my tags. I fold my clothes into cubes, into squares, because they have to fit the 2 suitcases. If by accident I have more than 2, what I tend to do is I'll go on the site, and check how much it is to pay for an extra suitcase. Sometimes it is cheaper to pay for an extra suitcase than sending my things with Salia because it'll take long, or maybe depending on the country, like the States, which come by ship, it takes so long and I am not patient enough to wait. Another tip is I usually have this portable weighing scale, so I weigh my bags before I leave the hotel so that I don't have to remove my things at the airport. I'm checking in, they tell me I'm overweight. So what I do, I ensure that my bags are within the weight range. And if you're having to transit to another country, for example, you're going through Emirates and you have to transit to Dubai, ensure your layovers. For me, I usually ensure my layovers are more than 2 hours or 3 hours. I actually like them when they're 4 to 5. Why? Because sometimes you might end up missing your flight. The flight could be delayed from where you're coming from, and they need time to transfer your luggage from one place to another. I also want time to be able to gather my thoughts, maybe wash my face, brush my teeth, take another meal, because don't forget I don't eat on the plane. So I like my layovers to be more than 2 hours so that at least I'm on time. Unless sometimes you land on one gate and you have to go to another gate, take a bus to the next gate or a train, so I don't miss my other flight. So ensure your layovers have enough time for you to sort out your stuff, otherwise you'll miss the flight. We all know that when we land in JKIA, the tax people, the carrier guys are there waiting for you, so ensure to know what. Read the rules before you leave. Ensure what, like for example, they usually say one perfume per person, or you can't bring electronics, or you can't bring more than 2 or 3 drinks. Ensure you know what is legal and what is not legal, so that when you come back, you don't have stress and you don't have strain. For example, for me, I feel like if buying a camera outside Kenya and bringing it in will make me pay a charge of 20,000, I might as well buy it here. It doesn't make sense. So I'd say ensure you understand the carrier regulations in terms of what you can bring into the country and what you can't, so that at least you don't have stress when you're coming back. Guys, before I finish, I forgot one very important thing. I always carry with me a power bank, which I charge the night before. So I carry with me a power bank, so by the time I reach the airport, it is full. And also when I land to my destination before I sleep, I charge my power bank. I have my power bank everywhere on the streets. Number two, always carry an extra phone which is open, which you can use everywhere. So I usually have this Samsung. It's an Android, which is very good. It keeps charge for long. So what I do when I get, let's say, to London, I'll buy a UK line so that I'm not charged crazy rates. The thing is, before I leave, I will top up my postpay, and once I talk to the limit, then at least I have my other line, which enables me to communicate from home, have Wi-Fi and data wherever I am. I can post pictures. So that's very important. An extra phone, buy a SIM card, have a power bank. And also remember, guys, we have different sockets in different countries. So remember to carry this. Not every country has the same setup in terms of sockets. And remember to carry a converter if you're going to use like a tongue or something that can blow up if you use it in a hotel. So guys, those are the tips. I'm sorry guys, they are random, they're everywhere, but those are the tips I've learned over the years, and I hope you enjoy, and I wish you a wonderful 2020 full of travels and new adventures. And share with me anything that you'd also like to add in terms of your experience with traveling, so that I can also share with my viewers. And until next time guys, bye. Don't forget to subscribe.